I'm Ted Ruger. I'm the Dean of the Law School, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you all here for this memorial service for somebody who is truly legendary and influential in the life of Penn Law School, Professor A. Leo Levin. We're very happy to have all of you here. We're happy to have Leo's wife, Doris, his sons, Alan and Jay, and a number of family members with us, so we're particularly glad to have you here. The large crowd in this room is a testament to the immense impact that Leo had over many, many decades here at Penn Law, and in many ways the legacy that he leaves that still continues today in the focus we have on classroom teaching, on commitment to students, on commitment to rigor in legal thought, all of which were attributes that Leo prioritized and that he inspired many of us on the faculty about. I met Leo only once or twice when I came to Penn in 2004 at a couple of faculty events that he was back on campus for after his retirement. And so I didn't have the privilege that many of you in this room had of knowing him well. But it's perhaps a testament to his influence that I nonetheless feel I know him pretty well through you, through other faculty members, through generations of alumni who have reached out to me in the past few months since his passing to email or phone call or write with stories of his influence. I realize now talking to colleagues like Chuck Mooney, Steve Burbank, and others who were mentored by Leo and in turn who mentored me, that this the influence and the commitment to teaching and student-focused legal education that is such a part of Penn Law was very much driven and inspired by Professor Levin and indeed does continue to this day. So in that sense, he's very much alive at the law school, very much part of what we do today and what we will do in the decades ahead. His influence carries on. Leo's presence permeated the law school for more than 40 years. He anchored himself here. He joined the faculty in 1949, but became an emeritus professor in 1989. Influenced thousands of students and dozens of faculty members in the course of those decades. Leo was an unforgettable character to all who met him or were taught by him, a renowned teacher who challenged his students, but also steered them with care and sensitivity through the rigors of law school. Leo himself had an intrinsic understanding of Penn law and what's distinctive about a Penn legal education. He graduated from this institution himself in 1942, later serving as vice provost of the university in the area of student affairs. Over the years and decades, he gained the undying loyalty of his students, many of whom are here with us today. And as I said, it's evident in the room today, the loyalty that he inspired. It's evident in the dozens of messages that I received from around the country, people who impact very, very personally felt his impact and are carrying it forward in their legal careers today. As you all know, Leo was unfailingly kind and gracious. He had high expectations of his students, but treated them with respect, and over the course of the years, many students came to see Leo as a father figure, mentor, and friend. As we also all know, and in oft-repeated stories that many of you witnessed, I suspect, and I know one of you participated in, Leo often went to great lengths to vividly illustrate the legal principles or psychological principles of evidence that he was teaching about. In one famous practice he would do every year in his evidence class that I received many, many emails about from students, it made quite an impression decades later, he would be teaching about some arcane point of evidence doctrine where from the back of the room, various individuals break in, one of them wearing a mask, carrying a pistol. I'm told that person may even be in the crowd today. Other people, we're not doing that today. I should say, I'm gonna pause for my current faculty colleagues. We don't, please no pretend guns in the classroom. This is a different era. We don't encourage this today. It's a nice remembrance. So think of other ways to inspire your students. But in the course of this class, another man would run on stage and remove his necktie. Another would deliver a pizza. Another would put a glass of orange juice on the podium. And then all would leave, and Professor Levin would ask the students to repeat what they saw, and thereby proved a point that social scientists have proven in less vivid terms about the fundamental unreliability of eyewitness accounts and eyewitness testimony that we base so much of our legal system on. So he was a teaching innovator in ways that were very memorable to his students. We have created a teaching award in his name called the A. Leo Levin Award for Excellence in an Introductory Course, selected by the administration and the students for excellence in really our most important mission, teaching students in their first year of law school. Many others who knew Leo better will speak after me, and indeed we hope many of you in the room will speak to Leo's influence on Penn Law and in your experience at Penn Law. I briefly want to just note in my role here, as much as we would like to call Leo exclusively our own at Penn Law, I do want to note the tremendous influence he had on American legal thought and the organization of the judiciary in the United States in his role in Washington, where he served for a decade as director of the Federal Judicial Center. As somebody who studies judges, I know how important that institution is, and Leo was the first and one of the only non-judges to serve in that role, and by the accounts of both Chief Justice Rehnquist and Chief Justice Berger, served exceptionally well in that role and really influenced their thinking and many others in terms of organizing the federal judiciary. So that's a contribution that he made to the legal community at large that still endures. Justice Rehnquist, on Leo's retirement from Penn Law, Justice Rehnquist wrote and credited Leo with helping to, and here I quote Chief Justice Rehnquist, helping to set the terms of the dialogue for the reform of our system of justice for the final quarter of the 20th century. So his influence emerged far beyond these walls. So I'd like to turn the program over to others in the room, and indeed any of you in the room who would like to speak, and just a word about format. We have five individuals who I'll introduce in a moment who will speak briefly about their reflections and who volunteered to speak. But this is, we envision this as, we know how many lives Leo touched. We envision this as a kind of Quaker-style memorial where we invite you to, after our five speakers, we invite any of you who would like to share your reflections of Leo Levin to raise your hand or stand, and please do that. So with no further ado, the five individuals who will we'll share first are Curtis Wrights, both a student of Leo Levin's and then colleague on the Penn Law faculty. An emeritus professor, David Chacko, who knew Leo quite well. Professor Steve Burbank, who was tremendously influenced and has written before about Leo's influence on him, has some remarks that will be read by another colleague, Chuck Mooney. Steve is on sabbatical in warmer climes in Berkeley this semester. Arlene Fickler, a 1974 graduate of the law school, will share her thoughts. And then Leo's son, Jay Levin, a 1981 graduate of the law school, will speak. But I should emphasize, those are just the first five speakers we want to. I want to invite anyone who has recollections to share to please join in. So, Professor Rhodes.
Fall of 1953, I put my first step into this law school building as a entering first year student. It was even though I had been here for 4 years as an undergraduate on the other side of the campus, I never put a foot in the law school before, and walking in was quite a remarkable, a memorable event in my life. Because the building had not changed since 1900 and was not in the best of condition. And I wondered what I had done by coming to Penn. But I quickly realized that the building was not what mattered, it was the faculty. Very shortly, we met the faculty in our first year classes, and they were and are a remarkable group of individuals who came together in large measure after World War II under the leadership of one of the great deans this law school has ever had, Earl Harrison, a man who is not adequately celebrated for what he did for this law school in the short years he was here. The faculty numbered 15 in those days, and no adjuncts. 15 full-time faculty who were teaching the entire curriculum. I'm sure that would sound quite impossible to the current faculty, although one of that 15 was Clarence Morris, who had previously taught at the University of Wyoming with two colleagues, where they taught the entire three-year curriculum at Wyoming. But it was a remarkable group. In addition to Clarence, we had Clark Weiss, we had Lou Schwartz, a legendary figure in our history. We had George Haskins, we had John Honnold, we had Noyes Leach, we had Ray Bradley, Ray's brothers here today, and of course we had Leo Levin. All of those individuals who made this law school into a first-ranked law school quickly, all of them were great teachers in their way, but they were all very different. It was the heyday of the Socratic method, and they were all Socratic teachers in a way, but all of them different, reflecting their own personalities. Clearly, the most memorable, the leader in that group in teaching, the man who made the biggest impact on us as a teacher, was Leo Levin. Now, being in his classroom was an absolute delight. He came in full of energy, ebullient, quick, but also very caring. He was a master of organizing the entire class to participate in whatever we were discussing. And he would move around the classroom rapidly. No one knew when you were going to get called upon. And if everybody called upon failed, eventually he would call on the Greek chorus, which we were all members, to correct the errors of the leading characters who had spoken before. But it was remarkable, and it was entertaining as well as stimulating. I once asked Leo how he learned to do that, and he told me that he had been very much influenced in his life at the law school by a figure, a man I never got to know, James Chadburn. Some of you in this room may or may not remember a man who for some reason was called Bunny Chadburn. But Leo was very fond of Chadburn and in many ways succeeded him when Chadburn left in the mid-40s to go north to some obscure school in Cambridge. But the classroom was dramatic, and we looked forward to it every day. Leo was a kind of special patron to law students, and all of us remember those days fondly, even though in that course we were having in 1953, the subject matter was the history of the forms of action in ancient England, English law. We were distinguishing trespass from case and probor and detinue, and reading cases with words that were so obscure that even a Black's Law Dictionary could not figure out what some of them were. But Leo was able to bring even that material into vibrant magnificent. It was a great joy, and all of us who were Leo's students will never forget being in that classroom. I was in the classroom when the guns went off and the pizza pie came in. That was a legendary evidence course, but that was second year. The first year was really quite special. In 1957, I became Leo's colleague, and we were colleagues for more years than the two of us than any of my other colleagues at the law school, because of Leo's long and wonderful life. And we shared many experiences in the faculty. One of the earliest I remember was indeed one of the first debates the faculty ever had when I joined the faculty, and that was whether to become a national law school. Penn had traditionally been a school that was the premier Pennsylvania law school, and certainly Eastern Pennsylvania, and had a rapport with the law firms and the legal community in Philadelphia that was far and beyond what you might expect today from any law school. And we were in a very privileged position, but most of our students were coming from the local area. And the faculty was debating whether or not to take the leap and go into the national arena. It was an interesting debate. The older faculty, the senior faculty that have been here in the 30s and 40s, were opposed. But the young faculty, including Leo, led the decision to make Penn into what is now one of the finest law schools in the United States and indeed in the world. And that decision was made carefully and consciously, and Leo was one of the leaders in making that important decision. Leo taught many of us on the faculty many things. Ted has already mentioned what Leo did in his career in addition to being on the law faculty, and I followed his advice in some ways. I too did some university service and did some public service in other ways, following Leo. Not many people are aware that during Leo's time in the university service, the university went from a campus on which most of the students were commuters to a campus on which most of the undergraduate students were residents. Transformed this university in an amazing way. Leo would be absolutely delighted about the college house going up across the street from us now. It was part of his dream to make the university a place where students not only lived, but studied. Well, Leo taught me many things, but one of the things that came back to me as I was thinking about today was a thought that I've never forgotten, a conversation I've never forgotten. We had a colleague in those days who had almost reached retirement, and the intellectual light had gone out. He was struggling. He was teaching from notes that were crumbling on tattered yellow paper. His examinations were recycled old exams, and every student in law school had a copy of the full set of exams and the full set of answers. So when you took the exam, you would walk in and people would say 16, 39. It was a hard time. And being a young Turk and full of fire, I went to Leo and I said, we can't let this go on. We have to at least ask him not to teach in the first year. He was teaching a major course. And Leo said to me, he said, Curtis, he says, just pray. When you get to be his age, that you will understand. He taught me humanity and humility in one conversation. Leo and his colleagues, his generation, have built a foundation for this school that endures and has expanded and become magnificent. But I think more important are the generations of thousands of students who remember Leo as a mentor, a friend, and somebody who has changed their lives, and I'm one of them.
When I received a clerkship in Philadelphia in 1970, a friend of mine who had been an undergraduate at Penn said, "I must contact Levin." That was that good advice. One phone call had a lead on an apartment in Center City, and once I moved to Philadelphia, I had an open invitation to join the Levins on Sabbath for meals, although the high quality of those meals probably had a lot more to do with Doris than with Leo. That one phone call led to a 45-year relationship with Levin family, in which I've continued to benefit beyond the dining room table. I renewed my contact with the Levins when we were both in Washington in the late 70s, and again I benefited greatly in mind and body from the Levin hospitality. Little did I know that Leo and I would also become colleagues at Penn, although I have Leo to thank for getting me in the front door here. I learned quickly that he was a professor par excellence. We've heard from Curtis and we hear from others, I'm sure, about that. But not only because of his expertise, but because of his congenial manner and his genuine interest in people. He was a supportive colleague, lending advice and insights that helped novices in the field of education. He was someone you hoped to find in his office, always engaging. He was ready to share his knowledge, but equally interested in learning from others. When you were with him, you had his full attention, no matter what the issue. I won't be telling you anything you don't know if I talk about Leo's extraordinary knowledge in the fields of evidence and procedure, among other things, or if I recount his public service in the creation of the 11th Circuit and his work at the Federal Judicial Center, among other legal endeavors that he led. What you may not realize is that with all his efforts in those areas of legal activity, he was also an expert in others. When he would greet me in the halls of the law school after we became colleagues here, he would not ask me about the latest Section 355 regulations. Instead, he would ask whether I had any new insight into the portion of the Torah we would be reading that week. And if I didn't, which was usually the case, he would have something at the ready. And it wasn't something conventional. It was always something novel, reflecting a wide familiarity with many sources of traditional Jewish thought. But his interests weren't limited to traditional Jewish studies. He was president, among other institutions, of the Jewish Publication Society, and when I came to his house, books of the society could be found not on display, but looking very much like they were in the midst of being read. I don't think Leo read these books so much out of a sense of responsibility. I think he relished the possibility of learning something new wherever he had the opportunity. His energy in everything he did was palpable. He didn't relax at home any more than he did in the office or in the classroom. And Leo was a founder of the Lower Marian Synagogue in Balakinwood, a much less public commitment than the others, but no less in need of sensitivity and time. To be successful in molding a diverse group of people into a community is challenging enough, but to be successful and remain beloved is the real challenge, and Leo met that challenge there as he did everywhere. We can celebrate Leo for the significant accomplishments he made throughout his life, but I think it's the warmth his memory leaves with all of us that is his most enduring legacy. May his memory be a blessing for us all.
Thank you very much.
Well, Steve Burmack asked me to express his sincere regret that it's impossible for him to be here today. But I'm very honored that Steve asked me to read his remarks in memory of our dear friend and colleague, Leo Levin. Steve's remarks. "Death, be not proud, though some have called thee mighty and dreadful, for thou art not so. For those whom thou think'st thou dost overthrow, die not, nor death, nor yet can lines, "Thou kill me." When John Donne wrote those lines in 1609, he was thinking of himself, an Anglican minister who had just barely escaped death. And he was thinking of matters spiritual. For me, and I suspect many others, his words have always carried a somewhat different message, albeit still one of hope, inspiration, and all the good in life that transcends mere mortality. For mortals like me who lack Donne's religious faith, his words aptly capture those rare individuals who, by reason of accomplishment and character, through the power of their example, seem larger than life itself. These are people whose faces we can summon in a nanosecond, whose voices, though long still, echo in our ears, whose energy seems by some miracle of space and time travel to lift us when we flag, whose kindness continues to comfort us when we are low, and whose luminous example ever lights a path that is true. This is my Leo. I see his smiling face, a twinkle in his eye. I hear his laugh, not the forced mirth of those who are better laughing at than with, but a tummy-rolling rumble of delight, particularly in the joy of others. I marvel at his energy, and I'm sobered by his steadfast ability to see all sides of a question that I have already answered on a partial view. If Bernie Sanders had been Leo's colleague, I can imagine him saying, "On the one hand, on the other hand, Leo, enough with the hands already." Leo was my mentor as a scholar and as a person. Much as he improved my scholarship, the gifts he offered every day of his life by way of example are much more precious. Of course, Leo was a person of faith, and I envied him that. Wondering how he packed so much work, so much life into 24-hour days, I ultimately realized that his secret was one enforced day of rest every week, when in the bosom of his beloved family he could recharge his batteries. And it is that thought which evokes one final image of Leo, the Energizer Bunny.
I was a student at this law school from 1971 to 1974, which was at the end of the first half of Mr. Levin's half-century career. That's what we called Penn Law School professors at the time, Mr. or Ms. Not Professor Levin, as the folks in Washington, D.C. used to call him, and he was working there during the second half of his career. I took classes from Mr. Levin each year. Civil procedure is a 1L, evidence is a 2L, and a seminar in equitable relief as a 3L. My friend from the class of 1975, Mike Green, now at Wake Forest Law School, summarized well Leo's classroom style in a tribute to Leo for the University of Pennsylvania Law Review in the year 2000, when Leo retired from the classroom. Mike described Leo as a whirling dervish who used humor liberally to develop rapport with the class and to diffuse the stress of first-year students, utilizing his remarkable array of facial gestures, mock surprise, genuine joy, feigned puzzlement, strategic indignation, and magisterial wisdom to supplement his adroit use of the Socratic method. By the time I was a student, Leo no longer referred to the women in the classroom as Portia. But he did continue to refer to the class, as Curtis has said, as Greek chorus, encouraging everyone in the classroom to comment on the Socratic dialogue between himself and a student. Leo is comparing the class to the company of actors who who comment on the action in a classical Greek play was particularly appropriate because the classroom was Leo's stage, his theater, his showroom. Leo was a demanding professor, pressing students to perform at their very best. And yet, at the same time, he was always entertaining with just a little bit of a borscht belt comedian. But much as I'd like to think back to those big lecture hall classes in room 100, which no longer exists, I remember even more fondly the opportunities to have a seminar class or a mentoring session at Leo and Doris's home on Delancey Place. It was the custom at the time for members of the Penn Law faculty to be assigned as mentors to groups of first-year law students. I was fortunate enough to be assigned to Leo's group and to be invited to Leo and Doris's home, where we came to know a more personal side of Leo. At home, he wore a kippah that he didn't wear in the classroom. The bar was open, and Doris was always pounding out a little something to nosh. Whether we were analyzing the propriety of injunctions in a seminar or griping about the fact that it was the end of February and our group of overachieving, overwrought first-year law students had not yet received grades, which would enable us to tell whether we were, in fact, learning to think like lawyers, it was a special pleasure to sit in the comfort of Leo and Doris's living room and discuss law and the law school. We soon realized that Leo's students were his friends and part of his extended family, even as he became our favorite Jewish uncle. But my relationship with Leo only began at the law school. During my third year here, Leo went to Washington, D.C. become executive director of the Commission on Revision of the Federal Court Appellate System, referred to colloquially as the Ruska Commission, because its chair was Senator Roman Ruska. Senator Ruska, you may recall, spoke in favor of mediocrity on the Supreme Court. When he met Leo Levin, he knew that he had not met mediocrity. And shortly before my graduation, Leo called me and asked me to join him in Washington for the second year of the commission's work. The commission was a group of 16 judges, legislators, and lawyers, four appointed by the president, four by the chief justice, four appointed from each of the judiciary committees of the House and Senate. And you should recall that this was 1974 when the House Judiciary Committee was thinking about impeaching a certain President Nixon. The legislation creating the commission directed it to make recommendations concerning the structure and internal procedures of the federal courts of appeals. Leo guided the commission in the preparation of two reports. The first recommended the division of the Fifth Circuit into today's Fifth and Eleventh Circuits, as well as the division of the still overlarge Ninth Circuit. The second addressed other mechanisms for accommodating the rising caseloads while preserving the integrity of the judicial process, including the importance of oral argument in inappropriate cases, desirability of an explanatory statement, no matter how brief, of the rationale for the court's resolution of the case, and above all, the need to assure the courts at the appellate and trial levels with an adequate number of judges. Working with Leo to prepare that second report was a masterclass in legal reasoning and writing. While my work at the commission was an extraordinary first job for a recent law school graduate, more important to me, it was the beginning of my becoming part of the Levin family. The next year, we worked together on the panel conference. That's the conference that convened hundreds of judges, lawyers, and academics as part of our country's bicentennial to mark the 70th anniversary of Roscoe Pound's celebrated address to the ABA on the causes of popular dissatisfaction with the administration of justice. Following on the heels of the Ruska Commission's work, the report of the Pound Conference, which Leo edited, set the stage for the discussion of federal court administration for the next quarter century, as Judge Justice Rehnquist so pointedly pointed out. And Leo was in the middle of that discussion. In 1977, Leo and Doris left for D.C. again, where Leo was named the first and only non-judge to serve as director of the Federal Judicial Center, a position he held with distinction for a decade, bringing academic rigor to the FJC's teaching of judges and its judicial administration research. He served our profession in many other ways, as a member of the Judicial Conference's Standing Committee on Practice and Procedure, as reporter to the Eastern District of Pennsylvania's Advisory Group on Implementation of the Civil Justice Reform Act, as the founding director of the National Institute for Trial Advocacy, as national president of the Order of the COIF, president of the American Judicature Society, a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and a fellow and council member of the American Law Institute. And in all those positions, he contributed to the academic debate through his writings. Leo wrote course books on civil procedure, evidence, trial advocacy, and judicial administration in Pennsylvania, as well as scores of articles on similar topics. From my perspective, he was a generous co-author. Even as he had been, as a student, had co-authored an article with his mentor, Jim Chadbourne, a still often cited article, Original Jurisdiction on Federal Questions. Many of his articles, Leo's articles, have been co-authored with his students, who had the unique pleasure of experiencing his insight, enthusiasm, and humanity firsthand. And while doing all of that, Leo remained an observant Jew and found the time to volunteer for the Jewish community as well. The son of a rabbi, Leo founded the Lower Merion Synagogue. He also served as president of the Jewish Publication Society and the Jewish Exponent newspaper in Philadelphia, as well as vice president of the Union of Orthodox Jewish Congregations of America. I can't help but think that watching Leo balance his work at the Ruska Commission with his teaching at the law school, his work in the community, and his religious observance inspired me and countless others to fulfill the biblical injunction in Deuteronomy. Tzedek, tzedek, tirdof. Justice, justice, shalt thou pursue. For all that work, Leo was repeatedly honored. Indeed, he's been honored here at Penn Law by having two issues of the law review dedicated to him, and by being awarded the Harvey Levin Memorial Award for Teaching Excellence, the Distinguished Service Award, affectionately known as the GOAT, for service to the law school, and the Wilson Award for service to the legal profession. All too frequently, when someone dies, too many people regret not having had the opportunity, or not taken the opportunity, to tell the deceased how much he or she meant to them during their lifetime. With Leo, we at Penn Law are fortunate, for we did tell him how much we cared. Indeed, personally, I have twice had the honor of speaking about Leo at this law school. The first time was when we presented that portrait to this law school. The second time was in 1998, when we presented him with the Wilson Award. At that second occasion, I summarized Leo's service and dedication in words that seem equally right to me today. We presented the Wilson Award to Leo for teaching judges how to judge and first-year law students how to think like lawyers, for using humor and hypos to make the Socratic method slightly less intimidating while innovating a new practical method for teaching advocacy skills to law students and seasoned litigators, for working tirelessly to eliminate the causes of popular dissatisfaction with the administration of justice while integrating academic rigor into judicial administration, for continuing to teach at the law school in Philadelphia while undertaking significant posts of public service in Washington, for continuing to handle a full-time teaching load for more than 10 years after he assumed emeritus status, and for continuing to be an integral part of the law school community even after he retired from the front of the classroom. For opening not only the door to his office, but the living room in his home, to students for seminars and Reich sessions, for intellectual discussion, for conversation and gossip. For being an advisor to chief justices, a sounding board to colleagues, a demanding yet supportive teacher to his students, and a friend to all. For spending 6 days a week teaching students, writing articles, and advising federal and state judges, congressmen, and policymakers, while being most comfortable at home on Shabbos as a loving husband, devoted father, and proud Zadie for both grandchildren and great-grandchildren. For being that rare combination of innovative theater, innovative thinker, and observer of tradition. For being so worthy of being honored, yet being so unassuming and so humble. For bringing honor to his alma mater just by being A. Leo Levin. Almost 20 years later, I can't say it any better. When Leo retired from teaching, the Penn Law Journal wrote an article about Leo in which he quoted the Talmudic phrase, "From many have I learned, but from none more than from my students." Judge Dolores Sloviter appropriately turned that phrase around in her tribute a few months later in the 2000 issue of the Law Review dedicated to Leo, as she said, and as I heartily concur, "From many professors have I learned, but none more than A. Leo Levin. I was lucky to be able to call him my professor, my colleague, my co-author, my mentor, and most of all, my friend."
It's difficult to go last because you tend to sometimes repeat, and I apologize for that. On behalf of my mother, my brother, the rest of the family, and myself, I'd like to thank everyone for attending this celebration of my father's life and achievements. I'd particularly like to acknowledge the efforts of Dean Ruger and Al Russo in arranging this memorial. It's very gratifying to see how many people are here, especially since usually when people pass away at the age of 96, almost 97, there's really almost always no one left other than family to remember them, who participated in life with them, and who can be examples of their legacy. And I think you, for coming here, show that that is not the case with my father. Thank you to Dean Ruger, Professor Reitz, David Shackow, Professor Burbank through Professor Mooney, and Arlene Fickler for all of your thoughts about my father. You all remember my father as I'm certain he would like to be remembered, as a teacher devoted to his students, as a mentor to junior colleagues, and a faculty member dedicated to the welfare of an institution that he loved and at which he spent all but 3 years of a 52-year teaching career. When you live with someone, as my brother and I did, you don't always get a full sense of their professional life. That part of them is at least partially hidden. Your remarks shed a light on my father's life here at the law school and give us a brighter picture of what he was like and how he was viewed by colleagues and students. At this time and in this setting, I think it is appropriate to remember two past members of the law school's faculty who served as my father's mentors and role models. And my father would have been the first to talk about them as opposed to himself, because he would always deflect credit from himself to others. The first is James H. Chadbourne, about whom you've already heard, who taught my father civil procedure and evidence. Chad, as my father liked to refer to him, inspired my father to study procedure and evidence and later teach these subjects in what Justice Holmes called the grand manner. That is, with consideration of both the technicalities of the rules and the larger policy questions that shape them. Chad launched my father's career as a law professor. When my father came back after World War II, he had a fellowship at Columbia Law School, and he asked Chad, "What should I do?" And Professor Chadburn responded, "You should teach law. There's a position open at the University of Iowa. I've spoken to Dean Ladd, Mason Ladd, about you. He'll make you an offer, and you should accept." And that's how my father joined the Iowa law faculty. And you can't imagine what it was like for someone born and raised in New York and Trenton, all of a sudden going off to Iowa. It was a very different world then. It's not as connected as it is now. So whatever success my father enjoyed as a professor can be traced in large part directly to Professor Chadburn's guidance. At my father's first meeting with the professor after he started at Iowa, Chad asked my father, "Have you learned to handle the bad ones?" By which he meant, "Have you figured out how to deal with the disappointment and frustration of a class that goes badly?" I'm not sure my father ever got to that point, but it was a question he would ask younger faculty over the years. Bad classes were inevitable. The key was how the teacher recovered. My father took his teaching very seriously. He prepared intensely for every class for his entire 52-plus years of teaching. In fact, he was virtually unapproachable in the hour before a class because he was so focused. He couldn't talk to you. He couldn't do anything other than prepare for class. And I learned that because one day when I was in college, I came to his office while he was preparing in the last hour before class, and he could barely tell me, "Get out, come back when class is over." During one of my father's first days in law school, someone said to the assembled class, maybe this is apocryphal, "Look to the right of you, look to the left of you. One of you won't be here next September." Chad didn't motivate the students with fear. Instead, he tried to inspire with a love of the law and the joy of the intellectual challenge. And my father tried to do the same thing. As you've heard, and I've been told over the years, he taught with humor and tried to make each class interesting, edifying, and above all, useful. I wish I would have seen him teach, but he never allowed it. He never explained why. He just said no. Dad's first law review article was written with Chadburn. As Arlene mentioned, my father was known for co-authoring articles with students. My father would tell my brother and me stories about how nervous he was when he was in law school, particularly his first year when exams came up. And he told us one of his professors told him, "Go to the movies the night before the exam to relax." My father said he saw more movies during exam week than he did the rest of the year. And he gave us that advice. He said, if you weren't ready for your exam by dinner time, studying all night long wasn't going to help. Well, I never took that advice. When I was a student here, I would cram all night and then walk in the next morning and take the exam. I did not see movies during exam week. As a professor, he tried to take some of the stress out of exams and sometimes would begin his exams with a reminder that even if you don't know the answer, it's still worthwhile to raise the question. And legibility counts. If your handwriting is bad, consider typing the exam so your professor doesn't go blind. I suspect that's much less of an issue now when all students type everything. But I remember him reading blue books in his study and occasionally pointing out to me particularly bad handwriting, usually to tell me what I should not be doing. But he always waded through them and read and graded every blue book at least twice to make sure he was giving everyone a fair shake. The second mentor was Jefferson Barnes Fordham, who served as dean of the law school from 1952 to 1970. My father was promoted to tenured full professor in 1953, only 4 years after he joined the faculty. It was entirely Dean Fordham's decision. As my father told the story, there were no committees to satisfy, no review at a higher level. Dean Fordham decided the time was right, did it, and my father was forever grateful. That being said, my father always felt a little insecure about the fact that it was just the dean who did it, And after he was away from the law school in New York for a year, and returned in 1970, the faculty voted him tenure. And he always very much appreciated that fact and would mention it to me periodically. Dean Fordham was a leader in the civil rights movement of the early 1960s at both the national and local levels. From Dean Fordham, my father learned how an academic must be involved, again in the words of Holmes, in the actions and passions of his times. Dad's research focused on ways to improve the administration of justice. His service focused on judicial administration. And his ultimate goal was always to improve how the legal system served its consumers. Dean Fordham was also very concerned with his students as people and would go to extraordinary lengths to reduce the stress of law school and make sure that individual students would do their best. Like Dean Fordham and Judge and Professor Chadburn, my father saw his students as friends, as an extended family, and as his teacher. As Arlene mentioned, one of his favorite sayings was, "From many I have learned, but from none more than my students." He opened our house to them. He had seminar sessions at home, he had other sessions at home, and I remember meeting students who came for those sessions, for those times. His door was always open to students, and I've heard from some of them over the years that his advice changed their career paths and helped them through very difficult decisions. In the preface to his civil procedure casebook, he acknowledged his debt to Professor Chadburn. Quote, "He challenged, inspired, stimulated, and above all, taught generations of students, and always for him and for them, joy in the enterprise." I think my father would be much more than satisfied if that would also be his legacy to the students he taught at the law school that he loved. Thank you all very much for being here today.
Thank all five of our speakers very much. As we remember Professor Levin, and I know there are many others in the room who have memories, I'd like to invite any of you who would like to share some memories to stand and share your reflections.
My name is Steve Mendelson. I had Professor Levin for a civil procedure in 1988, but I knew Jay before I knew the professor, and he told me that his father never let him go to class when he was here at law school, but he did ask me to record him.
I'm Amy Schwartz. I was in the class with Steve, and I had Professor Levin not only for civil procedure, but I had the pleasure of working for him as a freshman and helping him do research. And I remember being terrified going into finals, and he was such a great source of comfort in making me feel like, don't worry, you're going to do this. You will succeed here. And I've never forgotten that. And I was also fortunate enough to be invited to his home for Shabbat on occasion.
One of my classmates behind me just prompted me to remember something, class of 59, but I can tell you a thousand stories, I won't because you've heard them all probably, but one of the things that happened is our first class in the morning was A. Leo Levin. What a way to start a day. We loved him, and we learned from him, and the sense of humor was not lost on any of us. But one of the things that happened was he had certain little habits, and some of our classmates weren't quite sure what they were all about, because while he was wandering around and talking and pointing and picking on people, he would do this quite often. And he did it so often that one of our classmates said to me, "Why is that? Is that a tick? Do you have a problem?" Having come from an Orthodox background, I can tell you that he's moving his skull cap from back to front. It's non-existent because he's here at the university, but he's wearing it in his mind. And they thought I was a little bit crazy. Some of us agreed. And then we were fortunate enough to have a seminar and to go to the home of Leo Levin and his very gracious wife, Doris. And we sat there, and of course, in his home, he was comfortable, and he wore his skull cap. And we're sitting there, and we sat down, and we were in the couches and the chairs. And the first thing he did was to move his skull cap from the back to the front. And one of our classmates, who came from a Quaker tradition, said, "You're right." We then had a, I had to explain to the professor what it was that I was right about. He didn't think I was right about a lot of things. But I must tell you that all of us, and I particularly, I loved him so much that I sat on every word. So much that I later became the guy who mimicked him at all of the class parties. And it was out of love. If imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, believe me, it was done in that sense. So I did imitate him occasionally. I won't do it today, of course. And it was kind of an interesting thing for me because when I listened to him and doted on his every word, I did so well in the class that I even surprised him. Thank God for the anonymous warning system. Because he would have figured the clown shouldn't get that kind of grade. But it was good. Just one other thing, I must tell you that some years later, I was asked by the head of a department at another school, another university here, to teach some undergrad law courses. And I said, "You know, it's daunting, but I used to imitate it. I can go now and be Leo." And I will tell you, 22 years later, after a number of complimentary remarks from the dean of that school and some others, I said, "It wasn't me, it was Leo the whole time." And it was, and he will be with me for every day of my practice, and I wish you'd remember how much he meant to all of us.
I'm Ken Gelbert. Professor Levin was my civil procedure professor in 1977 when he just started with the Federal Judicial Center. He would commute up from Washington to teach a 9 o'clock course, and he always was the most energetic person in the room. Doris and Jay, I'm very sorry for the loss, but what we can do is remember someone who really deserves to be remembered. He worked gently but firmly. And he was also my senior writing advisor, and he was never directive. He would always say, "Where are you going with this? And how do you think this will help you get where you're going?" And all he would do is just nudge the slightest bit to inspire you to go off on a course of study. I ended up being the go-to guy for civil procedure in my office as a young lawyer, which is not something you would come to expect, but he had that kind of impact. He taught about working gently with people, is, "Hey, happy people, let's take some cases. What can it hurt?" Kept us all going at a time when a few people did. One brief story that really shows the way he had a touch with people and could inject humor. I had a classmate who should remain nameless, whose seat, the assigned seat in first year civil procedure, was right in front of Leo. One day, a perfect storm of bad events made the classmate late, and he dashed in as Leo was working on one of his first hypotheticals, angrily slammed down his books, which were the wrong books. And at that time, Leo wound up the hypothetical question and said, "And the answer is, Mr. Classmate?" And he said, in incredible frustration, "I don't have the slightest idea." And Leo said, "You're absolutely right." Go on to someone else and just let it go.
Hello, my name is Denise Colliers, and I was not blessed to have Professor Levin as a teacher while I attended Temple. But I had a wonderful year in Washington when I worked as his assistant at the Federal Judicial Center. And every day, it was a pleasure to come to work. Professor Levin was truly a unique person, a wonderful man.
course seemed comprehensible. You know, one of the problems of being a law student in 1969 was the Socratic method, where sometimes faculty were not as clear as they should be. Oh, I must say, Curtis Rice, you were very clear. You were but Leo Levin made you feel like this is something that could be understood. Also, what he did, which was wonderful, was he brought out the humor in law. And even now, you know, oftentimes the people, I'm a lawyer in Baltimore, Maryland, and many of the people who come to see me are in some of the worst circumstances of their lives, whether it's a divorce or child custody fight or whatever it is, they're miserable. And what I try to do is to mirror what I learned from Leo Levin in the first year of law school, and that is to cheer the people up, just like he cheered us up. And so the influence of a teacher is not just the thousands of students we may have taught, but also the incalculable number of people who those students have helped. And so Leo Levin's influence is enormous, and I thank him so much for that.
My name is Norm Veazey. I'm class of 1957, and Curtis Rice was the editor-in-chief of the Law Review. When he's much older than I am. He's class of 56. He was editor-in-chief of the Law Review when I was one of the foot soldiers on the Law Review. And I'm not going to tell you more stories about Professor Levin at Penn Law School. There are plenty of them. And it was wonderful to be in his class. But later I got to know him in the, as head of the Federal Judicial Center. And as you said, he commuted back and forth. But he was wonderful down there. I was Chief Justice of Delaware. And Chief Justice Rehnquist had appointed state judges and chief justices to be on these federal committees, federal state relations, federal rules. I was on the standing committee on federal rules. And Leo was there, and people would ask me, do you know Professor Levin? And I said, he's wonderful. Maybe he can walk on water. I don't know, but he's terrific. And not only that, but his intellectual curiosity, everybody knows about. He wanted to know what it was that we did in the state courts that could be translated to the federal courts to improve the federal courts. And I said, are you kidding? And he said, oh, no, I think the state courts are laboratories for these kinds of things because you have so many more cases in the state courts. I mean, tremendous number of cases in the state courts versus the federal courts. And he would then want to know what our ideas were to improve federal policy for the federal court system. And in fact, I would introduce him to people. He would ask people these questions. Take the answer, you know how intellectually curious he was. In fact, he would call us later, when we're back in our chambers, and ask us a question. You were talking about so-and-so. What do you think of this? That was Leo Levin.
My name is Bob Rosen. I had the privilege of being here and graduating in 1961. I came here with Ann Epstein Harrison from Wharton School. And as I drove down from Bluebell this afternoon on the Schuylkill Highway, I thought, what was the most significant relationship or accomplishment that I think Professor Levin gave to us? And it wasn't until when I was at Central High School that we had relationships with teachers. All through Wharton, I don't remember once having a social conversation with any of the very busy money-making professors, particularly the marketing people who came from Texas and had the next great widget to sell. But we came here and I had the traumatic experience of Clarence Morris, of Lewis Schwartz, and I wondered a lot whether I was in the right place. But by the grace of God, somebody figured out that my group would be mentored by Professor Levin and Doris, and we were invited to his home. He was a real guy. He was a regular guy. And that humanity changed my attitude completely about the law school. And it got me through a tough first year, a good second year, and a great third year. And also, in his home, if I'm not mistaken, I was able to see all 37 volumes of the Talmud. I had heard about it, I had learned about it, but he had, the first time I have since seen many sets of Talmud, but they are very large books, and they there's 20 of them, I think, and that 20 is a significant number, and they each have 200 pages, I think. There's a significance in the number of pages, but he explained that to me. It was and the chopped liver was great. I was very lucky to come here. I was even more lucky to be selected to be in that little group that visited with Doris and Professor Lee.
Well, I'm Howard Langer. I was here in 1977, and I owed a lot to Leo before I ever met him, because my mother was a childhood friend of Doris's, and my father was a childhood friend of Doris's brothers, and my parents met at their wedding. So for the first 22 or 23 years, all I hear about was this overachiever, Leo Levin, in their community. And then I got rejected by the law school and got a phone call after classes started saying, you can come. So I came down, and the first thing I did after meeting the Dean of Admissions was try to find Professor Levin. And then the first thing that I would say he did for me was he taught the introductory,
orientation.
The orientation. And, I had come here from graduate school in English. I didn't know a single lawyer. I didn't know the first thing about law. I just knew that I was a flaming lefto. This could change the world. Still am. But the first case we had was in the orientation was a 300-pound country music singer who was getting up from a toilet, leaned on the sink, and it fell. And I said, well, I can deal with this, okay? And that, I still remember, was my first case that I read as a lawyer. And then I remember the first case I read in civil procedure that he taught us was, I still remember the name, United States versus Benzik. What happened? Federal marshal was sent to the prison to serve somebody with a complaint, okay? And they left the complaint there, but the guy had escaped prison 2 years before. And that was the first civil procedure case. Okay, so he put me at ease, although I will tell you, myself and other people who he was friends with, their parents, found him to be actually a very demanding professor. But then in my second year of law school, I took advanced civil procedure, in which we were in class actions. And I remember he had Bud Diamond, who's sitting here, come to class and describe the class action he was involved in, and I said, this is it. This is why I'm here. And that's why I became a lawyer, and that is what I did for the rest of my career, were class actions and antitrust law that I learned from Professor Schwartz. And then at age 50, I got invited to teach here. And I was sitting in that same classroom someone else mentioned. Yeah, and I had taken antitrust there, and that's what I was about to teach, and I had Leo there, and I was just sitting there watching the students come in and saying, how the hell did I get into this position? What am I going to do? I've never taught in my life. And I got up and realized for the next 15 years I've been imitating Leo. I really have. Sometimes I'm nervous because they record everything. And I used to joke in class, someone's going to play this to Dean Fitz. I think in my mind, and then this morning I had heard Jay's remarks about how his father prepared so much for class. And this morning I had a bad class, okay? It was really bad. And I'm looking around, and up on the wall is Judge Shapiro glaring down on me. And I'm saying to myself, Leo would not have liked this.
This was my guilt was just because I hadn't prepared the way Jay had described how his father had prepared. So I owed him every little step of the way something, and I didn't even realize how much it was until I sat down after he passed away and started to write a letter to Jay and the family.
Nicole Galley, class of 1992. I wanted to add another woman's voice to the room because when I came to this law school in 1989, it was still pretty intimidating to be coming to law school as a woman. And I will say that probably the very last person I expected to find as a mentor was Professor Leo Levin, but he was also the very best. And I will be extremely grateful. In the first term, we had him for civil procedure, and another individual and I were running around crazy trying to figure out how to study. I mean, how do we do this? Even though we both had Ivy League degrees under our belt as undergrads, we felt completely out of our element. Everyone else seemed to have figured it out, and we had no idea what to do. And somehow he knew that we were struggling. I'm not really sure if he overheard us or what it was, or just some innate knowledge from all of his decades of seeing other students in our position. And he sat us down one day and he said, stop, just stop. You know what you're doing. You got this far, you can do this. And others have said this same thing. Do what you've always done, don't try to do what everyone else has done. And many years later, I just started my own law firm 7 months ago, and the same voice comes back to me. How am I going to do this? And even today, as I was thinking about coming here, those words came back. You know how to do this. You can do this. You belong here.
I think we're going to continue to share memories and talk amongst one another, both in this room and out in the Great Hall, as we share some refreshments. I just want to thank all of you who spoke. Leo's family, Doris, for being here. It's palpable and very meaningful for those of us who are still teaching here, those of us like me who didn't have the privilege of knowing Leo well. We feel like we do, in part because of your words, and we're more committed than ever at continuing his impact on Penn Law. It's very real what he brought to Penn Law. It's a big part of who we are, and all of us who are here look forward to carrying it forward. So he's very much alive. Thank you all, and I invite you all out into the Great Hall.
That's lovely.